you're sitting down, you're trying to figure out how similar the profiles are. We can do that whole process in 48 hours because we just say, okay, the objective for the AI is to match the flavor and sensory profile of this prior vintage.
You're listening to the Vint Podcast, bringing you expert interviews, alternative market insights, and exclusive access to the world of wine and spirits investing. Enjoy the show.
Hey everyone, welcome back to another episode of the Vint Podcast. My name is Brady. I'm joined once again in studio by Billy Galenko. Billy, how are you?
Doing well, despite your not wanting to. We're going to note that this is a pre-recorded episode because I'm in France right now when you're listening to this.
Yeah. You're in France. I'm where I always am. And we did two episodes this week, but our listeners are just getting this one. So we're really excited to get this episode out to folks. One of our only episodes on kind of the intersection of wine and technology that we've done like within the wine industry. So really excited for this interview.
Yeah, you randomly, I don't know how you found these folks, but the guy, people at Tastry, we interviewed Katerina, who is the driving force behind there. And it was really interesting. I didn't really know much about it before researching for this podcast, but coming out of working for multiple producers, both like my producer in Australia focused on both large and small volume wines. So like we were doing some bulk that was shipped all over the world, as well as individual brands. And then the producer I work for here also was straddling the balance. They had some estate wines. I was on those, but they also had some bulk. And it was just so interesting to hear about this tool that kind of would have drastically helped my job both times.
Yeah, it was actually Andrew Nelson at War Room and Bonnie Dune who put us in touch with Tastry and with Katerina, who we interviewed today. Yeah, super exciting technology, bringing machine learning to decision-making around how to blend wines, what decisions to make in the winery that will resonate with consumers. Sounds like Tastry has generated a ton of value for producers and retailers. And yeah, fits right in with kind of this vision for the podcast of wine to give people insight into all corners of the industry. I think we did that today.
I think the other interesting part is we're leaning heavily, like at least I was talking about for producers and how it can help people make better wine. But I think it goes back to something that kind of would vent the purpose of our company does is like saw a problem in the wine industry and we wanted to give more people access to the top wines in the world and how to participate. They basically were like, people are making wines based off ideas that they think people are going to, but they really don't have any idea. It's this top-down thing where experts are saying people should like this and it's going that way, or they're just watching what's selling and going with that rather than actually talking to the people. So like it's so interesting that their machine learning model really started from the people up and they're helping better understand the folks and it's ending in a better wine in theory for everybody.
Yeah, that's right. Producers hopefully make more money, retailers make more money, and consumers get wines that they're excited about more often. So I think that, yeah, that's definitely a win all around.
Yeah, no, I think that's people's biggest fear is they get the same wine over and over because they're worried that they're not going to like. If they had a little bit more assurance that they might, that would be great. Because if somebody like me with enough experience, I can read the back of the bottle, I can do a little bit of this and that, look at the tech sheet and get a general idea. And I like to get a different bottle every time. I rarely get the same wine over and over. And I always encourage other people to do that. And then I never really try to have the empathy to understand, you're lame. You get the same wine as no, you don't. They don't know exactly how. And so you don't want to pay 15, 20 bucks, come home with something you don't like, or even if it's only $5 or $10. So I think it's cool to figure out their mapping and helping people know before it even hits the shelves that people in that area are going to probably like these wines.
Yeah, and there's so much talk around AI and learning models and in this case, like machine learning. So I think it definitely fits too into sort of this technology moment of letting computers and like data sets, smart data sets do some of the heavy lifting for us. And so I think the wine industry is in need of some of that heavy lifting be taken off our shoulders.
All right. I have a random question for you based on some of the things she was noting. So something that I thought was really cool is she was basically saying what you you were eating when you were growing up or what you're generally accustomed to liking on a macro scale drives trends in your areas. She made the really cool point that wine with smoke taint is actually weirdly more widely enjoyed or accepted in Texas because of everybody's inherent love of barbecue, which I thought was hilarious. So my question for you is, what would the Maryland flavor profile lean towards? Is it like Old Bay in wine or what is it?
Yeah, that's interesting. I guess there are a couple of different ways could go. Something that we do here that I don't know how many other places do this, but this kind of idea of like fat and acid balance together happens a lot, especially like in the like central East Coast and down to the Carolinas, right? Like the barbecue sauce in the Carolinas or is all vinegar based. Have always like really liked vinegar. We eat vinegar on French fries up here with usually sprinkle like Old Bay on it too with French fries. And so I think that like acidity like resonates with me just like personally.
What if you think, what have you seen? What would you think your friends and family in the area, is there something that they really grab? Yeah. What are the average Marylanders or the, I don't know where you live in Maryland, but your town.
Okay. For people that I know out where I live, which is like farther out in where I grew up was farther out in the country, and people definitely have a sweeter palate overall for certain things.
So does that go with the food you would eat too? Like
maybe just like really like meat and potatoes, heavy. Yeah. Just like heavy diet of those things that are like starchy and rich and maybe sweet as well. Then I'm also thinking about as you head more towards the city and the coast, you get people are eating more seafood, drinking more beer. Baltimore is a huge beer town. And so I think about some of the, we've talked on other episodes about wines that resonate with beer drinkers. And so I think that like also maybe would play a factor as well. Yeah, that's a tough question to answer, but one that I think Tastry, this company does, sounds like really well.
Yeah, I like how we're trying to predict more of what people don't know they like yet and will like. And I think so what you got to at the very end there, I think makes a lot of sense with like seafood, whether it be fried or even like boiled crabs, a crisp beer with some bubbles is always good for pairing. Yeah. So maybe that helps drive a big beer market. Maybe a lighter like Piquette or some sparkling wine or something down the line could maybe fill that void or something natty.
Yeah.
I was thinking, it's funny
because maybe the most successful in my view, I don't have their balance sheets, but the best received winery in the state, Westminster, Old Westminster Winery makes wines exactly in that style. I think that like for me would really resonate with a light beer drinker, even like craft beer drinker who maybe drinks like sours or like lighter beers maybe.
Yeah. I was thinking about her too, because she mentioned, and I bring it up on the podcast, like, oh, a lot of the biggest hits in your area or even across the country just happen spontaneously. And my old company, one of their main products, I guess the main thing that drives the revenue that allowed their estate division to be created was this Stella Rosa wine, which is like it's like a Moscato di Asti. It basically is a base and then there are flavors. So it's like sparkling and slightly sweet, but it took off because the original winery is based on the east side here in LA. And there's a large Hispanic community that was actually in the neighborhood. And they would say people would just come over and grab a bottle. And that works really well, particularly like with tacos, things that are like kind of spicy, but also fatty and stuff. And it really played in with that. And I was like, maybe that does make sense. And then turns out Americans overall just eat a lot of either fatty or some spicy things. And that kind of just took off. I think that's interesting. It'd be interesting to have a technology to help find some of these unique things a little sooner and see what we can have. I think it's going to lead to a bit of innovation in the market for sure.
Yeah, I remember, I think this past summer, like my mom never drinks anything with bubbles. She just like immediately crinkles her nose and just like hates the sparkling aspect. I got her to drink a like slightly effervescent Lambrusco, like a bit off dry, but she loved it. And I like never would have thought that she would drink something like that. It was just like poured into a solo cup, like on the deck around the pool kind of thing. So yeah, I think that it shows that a bunch of different things that people don't expect that they would like can resonate if it's.
Yeah. So if they have the assurance, whether it be from a technology or a trusted retailer that was informed by Tastry, maybe they'll be more open. So that's my mission, is always to have people try more wines, and Tastry is helping do that. So I'm in. I like them.
Yeah. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, our interview today is with Katerina Axelsson, who's the CEO and founder of Tastry. She graduated from Cal Poly. She has her bachelor's in chemistry. She worked at a custom crush facility and kind of industry adjacent, also in the lab, working with some producers, and really latched on to this issue that a lot of these decisions were being made blindly and just making a lot of assumptions about what consumers liked or didn't like. So she taught, as she says, a computer how to taste, and Tastry is the result of that. It sounds like they're innovating a lot of really cool ways, and it was great to have her on. Without further ado, here is our interview with Katerina. Hey, Katerina, thanks for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, we haven't, I think maybe I talked to you a little bit in our, on our initial call, that we haven't had too many people in the kind of technology space adjacent to the wine industry. So it's really exciting to have you on today and hopefully talk about Tastry and what you guys are doing there, but also just about technology in the wine industry in general. You're certainly doing something unique there.
Yeah, thank you. I think it's about time we inject some technology into the wine industry.
Yeah, maybe we'll start there. Like, the industry is pretty antiquated, right? And so I'm sure you got your start somewhere and noticed this and wanted to implement a solution. So can you maybe talk about your background a bit, how you got into the wine space, the wine industry, and then ultimately what led you to Tastry? And then we can go more in depth there, but
I feel like everyone who ends up in the wine industry has some interesting story as to how they ended up there. But I went to Cal Poly University in the Central Coast of California, and I was an aspiring scientist. I was studying chemistry, but, you know, we have 400 wineries in a 40-mile radius or something like that around here. So the way I paid my way through college was by working at various wineries, large productions mostly. And I would be in the lab and do the other jobs. And I worked in this industry quite a while, mostly in the lab. But I was young and optimistic and ambitious. And you work in any industry long enough, you start to see the idiosyncrasies or dark sides of that industry. And the wine industry is no different. And so I would observe that we would be making multi-million dollar batches of wine, multi-year decisions, and things would happen like we would put the same wine under different labels, and then it would go out in the market and receive different scores from the same critics, and it wasn't very objective or transparent. But I think the most interesting thing I noticed is that it's very important that you make a wine a certain way. It has a certain quality. It has certain aromas. And it's a very big decision. It costs a lot of money, takes a lot of time, involves a lot of people. And it's all based on intuition. And everyone's looking at Nielsen scan data and trying to figure out, oh, how do I emulate or differentiate against my competitors? How do I know what the consumers are going to want? Are they still going to want it by the time the wine is out? And their best way to answer these questions was to sit in a room and sniff some wine and say, oh, I think it needs to be more tropical, right? There's a artistic component here, but usually the sophisticated palates and preference of the people making the wine isn't what the majority of consumers are drinking, unless it's a very high-end cult-like wine. So anyway, that was like a long tangent, but like I thought at the time, okay, what if I can just objectify all of this? And what if we can understand more about what consumers want, even though they can't describe it, by looking at the chemistry? And the answers we want have to be in the chemistry because we're experiencing it. The problem is we're looking at chemistry like a machine would, and we should be teaching the machine to look at chemistry the way a human would. So that was like the big hypothesis. And like part of the key problems, if I could just explain for a few minutes, is I read research on how people perceive flavors, and we actually don't really understand that really well. So even like multi-billion dollar CPG companies will spend money on focus groups and pour coffee or whatever product it may be. And half the people will come back and say, oh, this is apple, and the other half will say this is pear, because we have different experiences. And we actually found flavors and what you perceive don't even predict how much you like the product. So if you want a successful product like wine, it's all about consumers just having a positive experience and remembering that it's not about it tasting like cherry or anything like that. But the problem was, is no one could really figure out how to do that because there's a flavor matrix effect in the chemistry. So everyone's looking for, okay, how do I make this taste like cherry? But the problem is looking at that one compound is irrelevant because there's hundreds of other compounds interacting that are like a chemical soup. And it's about looking everything in one snapshot. So the short version is, after years of research with analytical and flavor chemists and machine learning experts, we actually developed a method that could look at the entire flavor matrix of a wine in one snapshot, the same way a human palate would. And that's how we like objectify this process and then relate it to what consumers actually like.
Yeah, I think that's so interesting to me. I worked a vintage in Australia at a larger winery, and I don't think people realize that there's all this romance and everything around wine, and everybody's, oh, it's, to your point, this subjective thing where the winemaker goes out into the vineyard and tastes with the vineyard manager, and then it just becomes wine. It's like there's most of the people really want their wine that they get, you know, in large volume to taste the same way every time. And they don't think about how that comes to be. They think it's like this romantic process. And I think what you're saying is really interesting to like help streamline that and make it a little bit more consistent. We used to have our winemaker would drive from Adelaide like 3 hours just to come taste and look at the lab report and then be like, do these two little things. And then he would go back away. We could have saved money for the end consumer if we didn't have him just do that drive every day just to taste 50 tanks. So I think your process is really interesting. And
yeah, and I know we haven't gotten into it yet, but that's actually, it's a really good point. One of the more interesting things about Tastry is it's not just about mitigating the risk of launching a wine that consumers are not going to like, right? We help make the best wine ever, the best wine you possibly can with the resources you have, and we do that very quickly. But where you see the more tangible benefits immediately is like the savings and operational costs, because you get to the result you want faster, right? One thing we do is like oak trials, right? That could take switching over from cooperage to staves or alternatives, right? That could be a very long process because you're running trials, you're trying from different vendors, you're sitting down, you're trying to figure out how similar the profiles are. We can do that whole process in 48 hours because we just say, okay, the objective for the AI is to match the flavor and sensory profile of this prior vintage. Here's the material that is possible or could be part of the recipe. And then it gets to that point a lot more quickly with the less trial and error.
I guess you can explain a little bit more how Tastry works. But I would say like one question is for when you're running these lab reports, it's doing its matrix. Does it give out specific quantities for like adjustments or like tweaks based on say what you have available? Does it say this much acid or 5 bags of staves? Like how does it denote the tweaks to make?
Yeah, so it's called computational blending. And what we do is it's a brute force method. The other side of Tastry is we have provided wine recommendations to consumers, right, for many years. And we have our own training sets that help us understand how much consumers like something. So basically, we have all these human palates we have gathered, which I could explain how we do that in like the cloud. And we call it the virtual focus group. And we run all possible simulations of chemistries of wine that don't even necessarily exist yet. So over the year, you know, in our software, we've analyzed adjuncts from all sorts of providers, for example. And we have hundreds of thousands of wine chemistry profiles. So what it's doing is it's figuring out what is the relationship in that flavor matrix when you add this oak or this acid or whatever it may be. And then it runs it against hypothetical consumer reactions to that product virtually. And then it comes back with the best possible outcomes and the recipe for those outcomes. So yes, it does give you specific quantities based on what you're looking for and what you're targeting.
Yes, that's really interesting. Maybe you can, let's take a step back and talk about specifically like what is Tastry? who is the customer for your guys' product, and what does it actually look like when someone agrees to work with you, and what service do you guys provide?
Yeah, sorry, yeah. I dived right in there.
Yeah, our slogan is, we taught a computer how to taste. We are vertically integrated, so we work with pretty much the entire supply chain. We don't charge the consumer anything, but we felt it was important to work with retailers, brands, and now distributors, because everyone in the supply chain wants visibility on what the consumer wants, and they want it as quickly as possible. And the way we're able to do that is we developed these two proprietary data sets that I mentioned. So we have one is on the flavor matrix of wine, and one is on the palates of consumers. So when we combine those two things, they mean the value of that data is different depending on who you're talking to. But they're all running simulations with it on our software, if that makes sense. So when we work with a retailer, they're plugging into our intelligence to provide personalized recommendations to customers, which helps them engage clients, increase sales. But when they get enough customer preference data, now what they have is a tool to understand what they should be putting on the shelves to reduce waste. So we can look at their inventory and we can tell them X percent of consumers are going to this wine and buy it again. So you should order more of this. And these SKUs are not selling because XYZ, possibly the palette match isn't great, but we can tell you what should be replacing those SKUs to drive repeat purchase. And then on the winery side, they do use the same customer data, but again, they're using it to understand how to make exactly what they want, what their goal is, faster and better and cheaper. And sometimes now that we have like traction on both sides of the supply chain and we're helping the supply chain understand what consumers want even before it's happened, we're becoming a bit of a marketplace where we have relationships with retailers and category buyers, and we have relationships with the brands, and they're sending data showing that they should be stocking their product because it's going to match better with their consumers compared to their leading brand in that category, for example. So it gets really complex really quickly, but just at the end of the day, it's all about anticipating what the consumer trends are and avoiding any customer having a bad experience, whether you're a retailer or brand.
Can you talk about just how you build those consumer profiles briefly? Like, is it a survey that someone fills out and say, I like this flavor over that? Or are they actually tasting something? How does that profile get built?
Yeah, actually, I'm going to try to not nerd out too much about this, but there's like a critical component here, and it's what differentiates Tastry from other companies, and we feel very strongly about it. We have a way to understand consumers in a scalable fashion, right? We can't run $100,000 tasting panels every time we want to understand a wine. There has to be a more efficient method. So what we did is we found a way to bypass the tasting process with, you could say, a deceptively whimsical looking quiz. And one thing I would note that we had to fight for a long time is the fact that some e-commerce companies have come out with gimmicky marketing tools that look almost exactly like this, right? But in this case, this palate profiler quiz is tied to the underlying chemistry. And that's, I would say, the biggest differentiator. So the way the science works here, just real quick, is we analyze the chemistry of the wines using our break down the flavor matrix method. And then we, over the years, poured thousands of blind, double-blind tastings to thousands and thousands of consumers. We had tested the chemistry of those wines. Those consumers, in the research, we were incredibly focused on how much they liked something, not what flavors or anything like that they perceived. So we got like a large breadth and depth of data to train our algorithms. But the key thing that made this scalable was, as they were doing these tastings at the same time, they were answering hundreds of these analog questions for their preferences for things that had nothing to do with wine. So do you like black coffee or licorice or dark chocolate or Pellegrino? And so at the end of the trials, we had the consumers rating for the wines, the chemistry of the wines, and their answers to these questions. And we used machine learning algorithms to understand the relationship between their preferences for the flavor matrices in those foods and how they relate to their preferences for the flavor matrices in the wine. And that's how we came up with, hey, in 45 seconds and 20 questions, we can understand about 85% of your palate with no, that's as a starting point, with no other knowledge or feedback or ratings on any other wines you've ever had in the past. And that quiz is can be deployed to millions and millions of people overnight. Basically, I can stop talking, but I could explain how this gives us an understanding of the United States and like the heat map of preferences of the United States. But that's how we started it. Yeah.
So it sounds like you've found a way to more or less, with sounds like a pretty high degree of accuracy, bypass the issue that you maybe described at the onset was, I like a wine because it tastes like cherry. And Billy likes the same wine, but he says, there's no cherry. I like it because it tastes like pear. That's not super helpful for developing these models, but the fact that we both like it is, right? And so am I describing it the right way in that you've bypassed some of that subjective, what does this taste like, and zoned in on some of the actual chemistry that makes you thumbs down?
I mean, that's exactly right. That's what blew my mind when we started this process is we were talking to multi-billion dollar companies that were doing research and they were focused on what flavors consumers perceive, that it doesn't actually help drive repeat purchase because A, consumers don't really know what they perceive really. And I'm not talking about expert wine drinkers. I'm talking about the general population. And it doesn't really affect their preference, right? So why is everyone focused on the characteristics when they should be focused on understanding what the consumer actually likes better? So I'm drinking this coffee right now. I'm not going to buy it because I thought, I think I got a hint of cherry. I'm going to buy it again because I simply made the decision that it tasted good and I think it will taste good if I buy it again. And surprisingly, there's very little research and understanding on that.
Now, I love the bottom-up approach rather than the top-down, rather than an expert saying this is what's in it, going from your angle and saying, do you like it? Doesn't really matter why necessarily. Here's some other things you like. Also, I'm thinking about either Maryland pears or cherries. I don't know how Brady and I would consider. That would be hilarious, Brady. I just like how you're like, if I taste pear and you taste cherry. Don't know what you're eating out there, but I would love to hear more about the heat maps. I was actually just down at, so I live in LA. I was at a family event in Florida, and there's just looking at the wines on the shelves there and even where I grew up in Virginia, they're completely different everywhere. I'd love to hear a little bit about what you guys have found in heat maps, maybe just on a broad scale so you guys don't give away any secret sauce, but that'd be cool.
Yeah, there are trends, and big cities are more predictable just statistically. I can't come out and tell you things. Like, it's usually difficult to make very broad generalizations. Oh, people in Texas like things that are sweeter. It gets a lot more granular when you look at the data this way. But there are trends in zip codes. And what I will hint at is the demographics aren't as valuable as people think they are. If that makes sense, it's all about culture. And there's a lot more nurture. There's some nature for sure. Like, people have biological preferences, but there's a nurture component. And I'll give you an example. Let's say there's a city or zip code where there are a lot of Japanese people. Some of them were immigrants and some of them grew up and were born here and they were eating burgers and milkshakes and that's how they grew up. The people who came directly from Japan were eating to and like Japanese food. Even though their biological preferences might be similar, the cultural effect on their palate is dramatic. So what you grew up eating affects your preferences way more than what demographic you're in, which is where the quiz is very helpful in understanding that, because it gives you a better idea on what your actual current cultural preferences are, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's really cool. Something that I thought about when we first talked was, who else in the space is taking a stab at this? It sounds like you guys maybe the first to approach this issue using machine learning. Is that right or not right? And who maybe are other kind of not competitors, but are there other companies thinking about the problem from the same angle that you guys are?
I think there are companies that are trying to understand the science of product development and winemaking. And our opinion is there are a lot of shortcuts there. And I think a lot of people didn't take our approach because it was too novel. It's very difficult for me to point to a direct competitor. Our business model is complex and it's new. The technology is an entirely different approach than the way things are done now. But there are companies that have looked at the chemistry of beer, for example. And what they did is they relied on experts for the training set, which we think is not a good way to go. But the experts were identifying these flavors and characteristics like we were describing. So how hoppy or how fruity is this beer, for example? And then what they would use, I wouldn't call it AI, but let's say algorithms, is they would analyze the chemistry of a new beer and try to identify, okay, how hoppy or fruity is it? And that's different from what we do because that's very quality like control. And it's not about generating new things or understanding what could have been if you have done this. It's not good at simulating better outcomes for the future, if that makes sense. Yeah, that's how I meant to say it.
Yeah, that makes sense. So thinking about that, who is your ideal customer within the wine industry? Is it, as you said, producers, also retailers? Really, where does technology like this deploy most seamlessly?
Yeah, I would say, so we have customers of all sizes, but we definitely lean toward larger productions, definitely above 50,000 cases. We've done some incredible things with very small productions, like in the event of an emergency, or if they wanted to understand the opportunity for their product better. But the reason that we leaned into larger productions is there's a lot of opportunity to improve the efficiency in how the products I made, right? These are like large scale factories, and it's about the economics and it's about the unit costs. And it's very easy to prove value there with a large production. Also, they are more often than not nationally distributed, which means that they can more likely leverage our data and understanding on how to get more business in retail. Not to say we've definitely gotten very small brands and placements in like Costco and Kroger and places like that. It just takes more time for them to wrap their head around it, I think.
I have two disparate questions. I'll leave. The first one is, what happens, say, down the line, 5, 10 years, 20, everybody's using your guys' technology and you've identified like, this is the optimal wine. How does a brand continue to differentiate from each other? Are they going to have programmed house versions of this? Or like, how will you guys continue to facilitate in a world like that?
Okay, so I hope I am understanding your question. And if I am, we used to get this question all the time, which was, if your AI is optimizing the wine, doesn't that mean everyone's going to be drinking Apothic Red or something like that? And the answer is it's actually the opposite. Right now, like before Tastry, when we first started working with clients, they were already trying to do that. Everyone's trying to make a lookalike of X, Y, or Z, right? They don't need our help for that. The interesting thing is they're doing that because it feels safe, right? Like you want the golden goose. You don't want to mess with the golden goose. But it's ironic because the most successful labels and brands that have come out were way more often just done on a whim, a creative whim by a winemaker who really just wanted to have the balls to do what he wants to do. So our data shows, why make Apothic Red, for example, when you could make something so much better? The problem with making the best wine possible for everyone is you get water, right? So you can't do that. It's not possible. The more people like it, the less those people will like it, if that kind of makes sense. And the fewer people like something, the more they're likely to like something. So if you see an opportunity for the materials and resources you have to do something different that hits a different niche or group of people stronger, you're going to be more successful. So we've gone through a couple cycles and we've seen that we're actually encouraging more diversity in the kind of wines that are coming out in the market because people have the reassurance, they're looking at data and it's giving them reassurance to do something new instead of going stale.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah, no, that's actually, I used to work at the winery. I was on the estate side of things, but the winery that created Stella Rosa. And that was basically one of their founders did that on a whim. And we've seen how that's taken off across the U.S. So it's funny, it really matches exactly what you're saying. My follow-up question was, utilizing your technology, obviously you guys are able to break down and analyze wines. Is there a plan and what would it look like to provide wine ratings that are completely objective and you're no longer relying on a James Suckling or a Robert Parker who may have completely different ideas of what's good?
You mean how do you make Tastry like the scoring system of the future, kind of?
Yeah, like how have you guys thought about that and what would you envision it looking if you did?
Yeah, the future is beyond personalized, right? Everyone wants to feel like they are catered to as an individual when they are buying a product. Our system does that really well. When you get a wine recommendation from us, we're telling you, okay, this wine is going to be a 92% match to you and an 85% match to your wife. And the rating is different depending on who you are. So it's not based on a score from a critic who has certain followings. The vision is people are less and less willing to risk $15, $20 without the reassurance that they're going to like the product. So I would say 5 years from now, whatever sensory-based product it is, even beyond wine, people will think it would be very unlikely for you to buy something without like the green check mark that says, yes, this is a match for you. It would everything runs through Tastry and you have reassurance before you make a purchase.
I like that idea. It's what's 100 for Billy is going to be different than 100 for Brady. I think that makes a lot of sense. I think that's really interesting.
And so you said 5 years from now, is there a consumer component to this? Is there like an app or something where, like you're describing, Billy or I could get a score and like profile for certain wines that quote unquote match?
Yeah, let me check if our personal app is out on our website. Anyone can get their palate profiled. But what our strategy was to do was just to plug into existing customer bases. So Tastry as a company, as a team, has always been a very strong tech team. And we didn't want to kind of risk at our early stage investing millions of dollars in acquiring a customer base to just be a recommender engine. So what we did is we partnered with retailers and it became a powered by Tastry model. So our recommenders on Dana Gauche, for example. You go on there, Dana Gauche is using the intelligence of this and recommending their inventory to their customers using Tastry. And then we get that consumer data and populate our database and give them back interesting insights. So it's a powered by Tastry model. We plug into apps and retailers and e-retailers.
And I guess the big provider of this kind of what fits your palate service is Vivino, maybe the marketplace site and app who has their recommended for you things based off of how you rate a wine or previous wines that you've tasted, which is why you're supposed to log them all. I never got to a place where I had logged enough wines in the app, but I didn't feel like it was super accurate at all times. And I'm a big Vivino fan in general, but would be curious to use your guys' recommender as well.
Yeah, let me send you a link and we'll make it happen. The other thing about recommenders like that is they use more often than not what's called collaborative filtering. And our opinion is it makes recommendations boring over time because... Yeah. Not to say that it's not helpful. I don't mean to sound too aggressive, but if your algorithms are focused on finding wines or products that are similar to the ones you've already liked or similar to people similar to you, right? You're just like, let's say you rated a bunch of Syrahs very highly. It's going to be recommending a bunch of Syrahs to you. But some days you might like a Pinot. There might be a Zin you might like. there might be a cab you might appreciate one day. This is just like a high level example, right? So if you want more interesting recommendations, you don't want to get stuck in that rut. You want something that understands your palate, not just a snapshot of patterns you've engaged in.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. I think I tend to agree too. I think there's definitely some limits to those kinds of models. And usually I'd advise people not to. I think everyone's always looking for what is the grape that I like? What is the style that I like? And just like you're saying, I can change day to day, and maybe the style of a certain grape just wasn't made in a style that you like. So you can't write that grape, that particular variety off. We all know that wine's a little bit more complex than that. Let's talk about the industry a little bit and just technology in the industry. Why do you think the wine industry in general is so slow moving to adopt new technologies and things like that? Assuming maybe at the onset that it's because of a risk aversion, right? It's a super capital intensive business. And so there's little margin maybe for some of that risk taking. But are there any other factors that maybe contribute to lack of adoption to some emerging technologies?
I think so. I think wine has been made a certain way for thousands of years. And a lot of winemakers have been successful in doing what they're doing for decades. Using another tool, even if it does make your life easier, it takes time. I don't think that's unique to the wine industry, but it is a particularly difficult industry to break technology into. I'm trying to think of other reasons. But what I could say how we overcame it is when we launched Tastry, we started talking to clients about solving their biggest problems and emergencies. So if you had to save this production, or you say everything was affected by smoke taint or something crazy like that, we would say, okay, great, give us a stab at it. And then we would come back with really good results in 48 hours, and we would save clients millions of dollars. And that did a couple of things for us. One, it got them on the platform and it got them engaged very quickly because they're doing something serious. They're solving a real problem. But once you're on the platform, you become more comfortable and it becomes more of a habit.
That makes sense. Have you seen any... So I'd be like thinking about this also through more of that romantic wine nerd side of things. Maybe it's a producer who doesn't want to change necessarily the way they're making their wine. They've always done it. They want to do lower intervention. They're like a higher end, like you said earlier, maybe a cult producer. Have they asked you to use your technology to identify like notes of the terroir? Like what does set apart our wine? Is anybody trying to use it as like marketing fodder, being like, we have this special thing that nobody else has around us in our wine?
I'm not sure. I'm going to have to think about that one. We have a lot of winemakers who have told their story and their experience with Tastry on our website, but marketing fodder, I'm not sure. Maybe I didn't understand the question. Sorry.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, no, it's. I'm still forming it in my head. I'm just thinking of somebody like, picture will go all the way to the top, like Domaine de la Romanée Conti, like DRC, everybody... Mm-hmm. Claims it's the best, they're making enough money. So they want to be like, we want to get our wines, and they would never do this, but, or maybe they would, but they want to get their wines analyzed to show these distinct components make DRC this much, but different one. Yeah, and they're just like trying to prove it out. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I think I get it. Yeah, I wouldn't say cult brands like that, but that's exactly how our clients work with retailers, right, is they will say, my wine is better in these characteristics and consumers therefore will like it this much better. That is exactly what it's doing, is identifying the best elements of that wine from a consumer perspective using science instead of subjective opinion. So that's our clients. A lot of them use us that way. Yeah, that is correct. Another way, maybe a cult wine would use it, we do work with some very high-end brands, is as a seed bank. If you had a very successful vintage and we analyze that, now we have that flavor profile to refer to with any future vintages when we can use it as a benchmark.
That makes sense. Rather than some people do keep records, but now you have a very specific record. That makes sense.
Way more.
Has anybody up. Yeah, I guess my other question was, I'm still like a not a purist, but going back to the idea of terroir, what if somebody's, I grow X on this type of soil. So they do like a soil analysis and they get a wine out. Has anybody tried to use that in using your technology to inform where to plant like the next vineyard? Cool. If this is similar soil, I'll take a clone. In theory, I should get similar wine out. Obviously, it's not that easy, but...
No, we're getting there. Right now, we're hyper-focused on post-secondary, but we keep getting requests and pressure to move into the earlier side of the winemaking process, going back to the vineyard. Mm-hmm. The farther back you go, the better the outcome, but we're just not there yet, but we will be there, I would say, a couple years. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. No, I can imagine. It's exciting. All the possibilities you have in my mind, just like all over the place, what you could do with it. So,
yeah, we've had to be very disciplined. Go ahead.
No, yeah. Can you describe is there an average palate profile for American wine drinkers that you could describe for us? Or is it more variable by specific demographic breakdowns or region of the country or something like that? Are there some descriptors that you can give for the types of wines that we most...
I'll give some fun, obvious examples, but there's natural smoke taint compounds, for example, and grapes. They exist even without fires. And our data, one of our clients was impacted, and our data showed that the wine would do incredibly well in Texas because in this particular case, there was a very strong barbecue component. So we've seen like fun, obvious things like that. I would say everyone likes to talk about how people like things on the sweeter side. I think that's true. But what's interesting is they like it even when they don't perceive sweetness. I know people don't think they perceive sweetness when they do, but what I mean by that is if you add a certain amount of oak or there's a certain amount of alcohol or acid, you can hide the sugar and it won't taste sweet at all, but people still rate those wines more highly because you get the sugar high in your brain, even if you don't taste it. So you're getting that hit of happiness from the sugar regardless of what you're experiencing. And that's like a latent variable we had to figure out because our AI isn't looking at what hits your brain like that.
So are you seeing that? So that makes me think of, we had a guest on recently, Peter Liem, who is like an expert in champagne. And he had a similar experience where they would do bench trials for different dosage levels. And he was like, there are certain levels where either the sugar would stand out or you wouldn't perceive it. And he's, we'd always found that sweet spot. And it wouldn't be that you could taste more. The wine wasn't sweeter than, say, 2 grams to 3 grams, but it just felt more complete. Have you seen it on the sugar side as higher is always better, even if they can't perceive it? Or is it like, is it always in balance working with the other components, as we traditionally say?
I would lean toward balance. Definitely balance. People like a little bit of sugar. Generally, it can't be cloying, right? Yeah, but I would say balance is usually key.
Nice. Yeah, as one would say, always in wine. That makes sense. Okay.
Yeah. And I hate making generalizations like that because there's always an exception, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I feel like a lot of friends who hate sweet wines that are cloying and love really ripe fruited red wines, and then haven't really explored like high acid but with some residual sugar white wines. And so I think that those three kind of categories are something that models like that would really expose. Yeah, this past weekend we had that experience where I had a friend who said I don't like sweet wines at all because I was going to give them a dessert wine. And obviously, it was a wine that had really high acid, and they liked it a lot. The sugar is kind of hidden by the acid.
Yeah.
Let's see. A couple other things, Billy. I know what direction you wanted to go. I wanted to talk a little bit more about trends and see if we could lean in there. What kind of if you look ahead to maybe emerging trends in terms of consumer preference or things like these, or what some producers are aiming to try and accomplish with their wines, is there a clear kind of trajectory or trend in terms of what you're seeing? And has that changed since you first got into the wine industry?
I would say it's not super clear. It gets very like specific skew level for us. So what we're really good at is identifying, okay, these are the things that exist in the market and it's hitting the consumers and they like it this much, but this is what's missing. There's a missing gap here that could cater to people and this product doesn't exist yet. So we could look at potential trends or rather predict them if we had enough simulations for that. But I would have to say there's more than taste when it comes to trends. Like there are more variables, like marketing is a big component of trends. And we're looking at how does marketing affect how much people like a product, but we're getting there. Like the low alcohol category. Yeah.
I said the example of the wine that you described where they put the same wine in two different bottles with different labels. Like that, I feel like really resonates with me as someone who probably used to buy wine based off labels and probably still do. You know what I mean?
Totally. Yeah.
Yeah. What are you drinking personally these days? Do you drink a lot of wine or are you too deep into it that you can't anymore?
Yeah, I'm sitting here with 20 glasses of wine and saying, I'm working. I ended up in Bordeaux and Burgundy. Like they joke about, you have enough wine, you end up in Burgundy. Definitely something I like to have with duck fat fries. Something unusual is I do like Brut Nature sparklings. Mm-hmm. And people in the company call me Bubbles because my go-to drink is usually a sharp sparkling wine.
Nice. Are you still based in San Luis Obispo?
Yeah, that's our home. Come on over if you ever want to have some wine.
Yeah. No, I definitely, I actually went there for, I number one, I had no, I moved to California almost 5 years ago, so I had no idea where Cal Poly was. And we went up to spend the weekend a couple weeks ago in San Luis Obispo. And I had no idea how interesting of a town, a nice little town it was. Like we'd always gone up to Paso. Like I said before, I worked with people who owned vineyards in Paso and Monterey and never made my way down. It was cool. They have that. There's like a little champagne shop there we stopped by. I'm not going to try to describe it, but I'm sure. But that's interesting. Because now I think of San Luis Obispo and the sparkling wine I had there. So, yeah.
Yeah. It's a happy place to be.
Yeah. Tons of energy. Circling back real quick, though, have you found yourself working with any producers and then starting any rivalries? Is there anybody who's, aha, like I knew these wines from this area were way better, and like people making like either personal changes or like even business decisions. Like we're going to focus more now on Paso fruit than like Napa where we were sourcing before. And like the bosses, I knew it. We should have always gone the better value route anyway. And it's better fruit.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Our data has affected very big business decisions. And it's not always about management making that decision. Sometimes, actually, more often than not, it's supporting what the winemaker is trying to convince the business of. So in one case, we had a winemaker who said, this wine should not be more sweet. And the owners were like pressuring him. And he pulled out Tastry data and said, actually, we're going to lose 18% of our customer base if we increase the sugar by this much. And ownership was like, oh, okay, never mind. In another case, a winemaker's label wasn't doing really well, and sales was telling him to change the wine. And our data show, and he kept saying, you're selling it in the wrong category. The quality is not correct for the price point. It needs to be in a higher price point. And sales is hesitant to raise the price of what they're selling. But our data showed that the predicted price of his wine was much higher than what they were charging for it. And that data convinced sales and management to change the price, and the repeat sales went through the roof.
Wow.
There had decisions like that have been. Having a piece of paper with data that is reassuring is definitely accelerating like big decisions, I feel like.
Oh, yeah. I've been on the other side of multiple of those decisions where it's like you try to cobble together what you think, but in the end, it's really just based on like comparisons and general ideas. Like you have no ideas. I think that would have been super helpful. And I guess going back to your own personal preferences, has any of the data informed your moving anywhere to your tasting or anybody on your team's like, I never would have thought to try this wine. I did now and I actually like it.
Yeah. I remember having a moment. So I used to make generalizations like, oh, I don't Zins, just not my thing. Didn't want to fall into that trap. But the AI is actually really good at identifying any varietal you might like, whether or not it's your typical go-to style. There's going to be a wine you like that is not in your style. It's very good at that. I do having experts or like people who drink a lot of wine engage in this, because they're more open-minded about trying a variety of things. I just want customers to get out of that mindset. Oh, I'm a Pinot drinker, or I'm a cab drinker. Yeah. Yes, in short.
Nice. Now, that's exciting. I'm going to start using, because I'm the opposite. I like to just drink everything, regardless, especially if I've never had it, just to try. But I need to convince other people to do the same. So now I'll just start pointing to Tastry data every time I need to, and just be like, see, I knew you would like it.
Exactly. We're complex, wine. Yeah.
That's right. I wish I had something like this to whip out too with my friends. We could, I feel like you could start a pretty cool wine society or wine club around like some of these data points and stuff and exploring wine with people together. But thanks so much for sharing and for coming on to talk about Tastry and to talk about the industry overall. I think what you guys are doing is really neat, both for consumers and for producers. Sounds like adding a lot of value, which I think is great for everyone.
Yeah, thanks so much for the awesome conversation. This has been fun.
We'll talk to you again, hopefully sometime soon, and make sure you send over the score. What do you call it? The test?
Yeah.
I was going to call it a scorecard, but...
I would just say, I'll say quiz, but that's not even accurate. Was that, there's a right or wrong answer.
I want to do
survey. Survey is what we call it. That's what it is.
Survey. Yeah. Send that over. And Billy and I will take in, maybe we'll talk about on our next episode, but we really appreciate having you and we'll talk to you again soon. Okay.
All right. Have a good one.
To check out our current offerings and to sign up for the Vint platform, find us at www.vint.co. That's www.vint.co. For questions, comments, or feedback on the Vint podcast, please email us at support@vint.co. Vint and VV Markets are offering securities pursuant to Regulation A. Our offering circulars amended can be found on the SEC website. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. Investments such as those on the Vint platform are speculative and involve substantial risks to consider before investing. We may provide communication that may contain certain forward-looking statements that are subject to various risks and uncertainties. Information provided in any communications, including this podcast, is not legal, business, or tax advice. All prospective investors should consult a legal, tax, or business advisor concerning the subject matter of any communications and any offering.